In 1974, the first tabletop role-playing game was created. Since then, people from all around have gathered to play. Join me as we talk with RPG enthusiasts while they share their best, worst, and favorite moments. This is You Had to Be There.
Hey everyone, welcome to You Had to Be There, a D&D storytelling podcast. I'm your host, Tom DeSillis. Before we get started, I always got to give my credits. So my logo for my awesome intro was created by Nicole Summers from the Reliably Chaotic podcast. It's a D&D campaign podcast with fun characters and a great story. And then my music for that intro, leading up to that awesome logo, was created by my good friend Michael James McGarry. You can find his music at It's MJ Music on SoundCloud, and you can follow him on Instagram at It's MJ Made. And that'll lead us to my guest of today is Kenneth Blaney. Hello, Ken.
Hello.
All right. So my first question to all of my guests is I want to know what led you down the road to RPGs, tabletop role-playing games. How old were you when you started?
I was older than most people. I actually didn't play my first actual game of Dungeons & Dragons until grad school. I don't even really know how anybody knew him or where he came from, but he was a regular at a bar in Hoboken.
Story is starting already. Somehow, I'm a weird guy at a bar in Hoboken.
It always starts in a bar.
It's just a D&D rule.
All right.
That's true. That is very true.
He was talking to a number of people in the financial engineering department at Stevens, and he knew that a bunch of us were math nerds. So he's just like, oh, have you ever played Dungeons & Dragons? And we were like, no, none of us had. He's like, well, I'll run a game for you. And that was quite possibly the most ridiculous, chaotic, came up with it as he went along campaign that you could possibly think of. Like, you've heard of dungeon masters who like plan?
Yeah.
This was not his thing at all.
It's funny you say that, because apparently I just keep finding it. I feel like each of my episodes are now going in succession, because my first episode was like the first time playing was DMing. Second one, same thing, first time playing DMing, but also was like that. My last guest, he did not plan anything. He bought the books. He bought the rule books and just made up something for his first time ever. But was this guy an experienced DM? And it was just like, I just make up stuff on the fly?
He had been playing since the 70s.
Okay. All right.
Ironically, he was playing in the 70s when he was in grad school at Texas A&M.
Oh, wow. Okay. I mean, I guess it's a little different for him because it was created when he was in grad school.
Right.
It was
yeah.
you kind of like me. You're a late bloomer, I guess. But
the first exposure I had to D&D was when Diablo 2 came out.
Okay.
They shipped it in a box, and in the box, because Diablo 2 is based on a D&D campaign,
okay,
where like you get the sorceress and the barbarian and all that from.
Okay.
They shipped out these like little character sheets, and I think that was a second edition character sheet.
Okay.
With this little like map that had a campaign on it that basically taught you the basics of how to run a game and how to play a character.
But this came with the Diablo computer.
That came with Diablo 2, yeah, with the game.
The computer game. So you would buy the computer game and they would send you like some RPG stuff?
Oh yeah, it was a tiny little, it was a pamphlet basically.
Oh, okay. It was like, I think that's how like, you know, Scientology starts too. It starts with a pamphlet, I guess. I don't know.
Well, so you've probably heard that the first edition of Dungeons and Dragons that a lot of people talk about is AD&D.
That's actually
maybe
a new phrase to
okay.
me.
AD&D, just like people talk about D&D, right? Like it's AD&D stands for Advanced Dungeons and Dragons.
Gotcha.
And you're just like, well, if that's the first edition, why is it the advanced one? The original Dungeons & Dragons actually shipped on a pamphlet that was just a piece of paper that was folded in three. Oh my God. All of the rules for it were there.
So you needed a magnifying glass, or were there just not that many rules?
The idea of early Dungeons and Dragons, and this is apparent even in AD&D, the first edition, is that if there aren't rules for it, the GM would come up with it on the spot.
Got it. Very cool.
So, like, first edition didn't really have, like, feats or things like that.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, kind of makes sense.
It had a couple of things that you were proficient in, but by and large, you didn't really get a whole lot as you leveled up. You maybe got a couple of extra hit points, especially if you were a fighter or something like that. You got an extra spell slot, but fifth level characters and second level characters could adventure together, no problem.
So the level up didn't really give you like the hefty boost, the game changing boost that it does today.
It wouldn't be until like third edition or so, at least from my knowledge of it, where the idea that you play a campaign from like level 1 to level 20 mm-hmm. actually existed. First edition Dungeons and Dragons, you were not expected to get to make like
it
to level 10.
Yeah, right? Yeah, yeah.
Like level 10 are those are the impossibly god, you know, fighting monster characters.
So not to go too far on a tangent here, but like for someone who started a little bit later in the game, you have clearly gone down the rabbit hole of learning the history.
Well, so I started in like, you know, 2013 or somewhere around there, right? 2013, 2014. But the old guy in the bar who the group together.
I'll tell you
he was
about just like, the real Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah, no, that was exactly it. He was just like, listen, this is the original book from 1973.
Is that the one that you originally played too?
Yeah. Yep.
Oh, so he was like, we're gonna play, but we're gonna none of this. I guess what edition was out then? Was it
first edition? Yeah.
No. When you played in the bar, what edition was out in 2013?
Oh, fifth edition was out by then.
It was fifth edition. So he was probably like, everything after this was nonsense.
Yeah. Oh yeah, absolutely. He didn't care at all. He was just like, second edition of the game, but I already own all the first edition books.
Right.
They didn't go bad just because they made a second edition, you know?
Yeah.
So, first edition had a very different mindset than, like, fifth edition or Pathfinder.
Well, it was super, like, just dungeon crawly, right? It was just straight. There wasn't as much, the roleplay wasn't so heavy, right? Wasn't it mostly...
Let's talk about the one
that you played. So, like, the campaign that you played, how did he go about it? Like, what kind of a character did you have? Let's start with that.
There was three players in that. My friend Tom was playing a gnome illusionist. My friend Gary was playing I cannot remember his class to save my life, but he was a drow with everything you can imagine about drows. He was the quintessential drow. I actually joined a session later than everybody else, and he was just like, yeah, I said I was playing a chaotic evil character, but then he, like, John, the GM, he's just like, but he said I was playing it more chaotic neutral. He goes, what's chaotic evil? I'm like, well, it's like the Joker. And he just was like, all right, I'm going to turn the Joker knob up to 11.
I'm going
to
do that then, oh boy.
Yeah. And I was playing a monk.
Okay, cool. So so how did he then kickstart you into this? It just
so the two of them had a session where they murdered the bartender.
Not at the bar in Jersey, right?
Yeah, right. Yeah, no, poor Izzy.
Yeah. So the party murdered the bartender right out the gate.
So the party murdered the bartender. They then stuffed him in the basement of the bar. My character came in thinking like, oh, these are the two guys who own the bar. some stuff happened. There was a local the bar was at this crossroads, right? Mm-hmm. So we could go in any direction from there, but somehow or another, I don't exactly remember how they got there, but they found that there was a abandoned mansion nearby, about like a 2-3 hour walk from the bar.
Okay.
So we went over there exploring it, and the mansion, of course, was like decrepit and falling down, but it had a fairly large like tunnel bored into it, which led down into a mine. This abandoned, probably dwarven mine.
Right.
Venturing down into there further, we found it wasn't quite a lava flow, but it was like the two with the dark vision could see it, that it was like super hot, because dark vision in first edition was specifically either what they refer to as ultravision or infravision. You could either see infrared light or you could see ultraviolet light.
Oh.
They didn't have this low light.
So it wasn't dark vision. It was like a...
As long as something is, it has a heat source to it.
Heat source. You can still see it. Interesting.
So the... So they could see that the ground in this chasm was very hot.
Mm-hmm.
And that there were like bodies that were cooking on it. We didn't really have the supplies to like spelunk further in without like falling in, because first edition characters, they're meant to die,
right? Okay.
So it's like, if we don't plan before trying to do this, if we try to do something stupid, one of us is totally falling into that and just dying and rolling the character.
Right.
So we're gonna be a little more careful. We went back, we got some supplies, and then eventually got further down into it. I think there was two lizardy type creatures down there who were fighting over something.
So he was just making that up along the spot. So then,
yeah.
How long did that campaign kind of run through?
Like, it lasted. I mean, 7 or 8 sessions. His lack of preparation really kind of pissed me off, and I just left. I was just like, this is dumb, right? Like,
right.
There's some funny aspects to it, but like, you shouldn't have to roll dice because I want to buy a spear at a blacksmith, right?
Oh, to see if like the blacksmith, of course, it's a blacksmith.
If the blacksmith even will do business with me. So I got like, I'm pretty pissed about that. And I was just like, no, I'm done with this.
Gotcha. That's interesting, because I feel like I've heard a few here or there stories where people, did you, like, after that, were you like, this game's kind of stupid, I don't like it, or did you seek out other people that
might
be more like-minded in
preparation? The two guys from that campaign, specifically Gary, he was just like, hey, my roommate's martial art instructor, he also plays D&D. He's gonna come in and run a game.
Okay.
Like he played in like 1 or 2 sessions of John's game. He's like, he also runs a game, or also plays. He's gonna come in and run the game. He's gonna use a set of rules called Pathfinder.
Okay.
Which is how I got into Pathfinder.
All right.
And so he's just like, you know, and I'm like, no, I'm not gonna do that. And it's just like, no, he seems to actually plan something ahead. He won't be as weird as John was. And I'm like, all right, cool. So I went and I played a dwarven cleric with that.
Cool. Was this Pathfinder 1?
This was Pathfinder 1, yeah. Pathfinder 2 hadn't come out and wouldn't come out for another, like, 7 years.
Okay, all right.
7, does that make sense? No, probably closer to 5.
5, gotcha. So really, you only played D&D first edition for like a few sessions, and then you're like hopped right into Pathfinder, and you've pretty much played Pathfinder ever since.
Yep. The only other system that we had dealt with, I think, was the Dresden Files game, which is part of a system called Fate.
Okay.
We played exactly one session of that, but then the GM of that was just like, I really need to learn the rules of this if we're going to play this again.
Right. How heavily different? What's it called again, you said?
It's called Dresden Files, is the series of books.
Dresden Files.
Yeah.
And then is that like a D20-based game also, or is it...
No, it runs off a game system called Fate, which, again, I don't know the rules of it all that well. But it was a whole thing where, like, instead of dealing damage and all that stuff, you, like, roll a d20 to see if you hit, and then roll a d8 to see how much damage you do. Most of it was, like, you do something that puts a condition on someone else, and then they have to obey that condition, or they spend a fate point to act out of character, essentially.
Okay, kind of like to just nullify that effect. And then when you, if you run out of the fate points, does something bad happen, I guess? You die.
There's a thing where, like, I mean, this was years ago.
If you don't remember.
If anyone who was watching this plays Fate, they're going to be like, no, that's not how you do it
at all.
That's
not right, right. Like, I'm sure I'm going to eventually piss people off, but, you know.
No, it was a thing like, you have a max fate points, and you spend your max fate points to get more abilities to do things like put conditions on someone else. And if your max fate points drops below 0 or 20, you essentially become an NPC. You have no say over what your character does anymore.
Interesting.
So the lower fate points you get, the more NPC-like you become, the less ability you have to control yourself.
You become a robot.
Yeah, exactly.
That's a really fascinating way to play. That's like almost borderline nerve-wracking, because you're like, I don't want to be an NPC, I won't play.
Yeah, exactly.
That's funny. So you tried that and you're like, that's not the one. You dipped your toes
in.
We didn't
really know the rules. One of the guys, actually several of the people, were very interested in the Dresden Files book, and they're like, oh great, well then we can just do this,
right?
And we didn't
right. So you had your friend, you had your Pathfinder game. How was and then how far into that did you start, like, DMing and stuff like that, your own games?
The first game that I DM'd was actually at one of my old jobs.
Okay.
When I was at product placement again. We made these.
The dinosaur?
Yeah, the dinosaur. Go to Amazon and buy one. No, so anybody who's listening, do not do that. They don't work anymore. Company went out of business. But yeah, we... there was some interest. We decided to put together a work game. One of the guys was just like, oh, Ken knows the rules of Pathfinder, you can go ahead and run a game. So I kind of got drafted into GMing.
I feel like that happens.
I was like, how many people are interested in playing? And I put together like 3 or 4 people. And I was just like, you know what? I want to like round this out with someone else who knows the rules. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to have to like do this all myself and do all the heavy lifting. So I brought in my friend Gary, who was in the game with John.
Right.
So I brought him in to play and help me back up the rules and all that.
Gotcha.
And then he would get a job at that company.
Ah, all right.
That happened.
Unfortunately, I guess, because they went out of business. But
well, it was okay. Yeah, actually, I mean, completely non D&D related, but yeah, he got a job at that company, and then when that company went under, he got most of the people at that company jobs at the place where I now work. So
there you go. And it all boils in. It is D&D related, because you play D&D together. Yeah. It's amazing how like almost all of like your experiences with, it's like these instances, except for maybe the guy at the bar, but it was like you were with people that were working like a normal job, and they're just like, oh, of course. Okay. Like that's the fun part, I think, about all this, is when you just like the average person that you wouldn't expect, they're like, what are you talking about? I love that thing. Like, that's amazing game. Yeah. It's a great game. Nice. So why don't we let's send this ball over to you. Like, what are your some of your favorite moments, memories, characters, things playing, because you've been playing for, you said, what
yeah, for probably
seven-ish years. Yeah,
it's
a good chunk of time.
You know, so playing the work game at Elemental Path, I got this sense about what GMing was with my normal group, how it was kind of like the GM has something in mind that he wants to do, but then you need to respond to what the players do, and it's almost like the player's job to screw up the DM's game. What it was I talked to everybody individually beforehand. And I said, what kind of character do you want to play? And this one guy, Danny, he goes, can I play like a dinosaur man? Like, is that a thing? And Pathfinder is, it's open source enough that you don't need to like go ahead and go through books, everything. There's websites online that just have everything you need.
Right.
So okay. I essentially found a lizard man. I'm just like, we're going to, you know, it's fine. He can be a dinosaur-like guy. That's a problem.
Right.
Or no, he said dragon man, not dinosaur man.
Okay.
And 5th edition has dragonborn, Pathfinder does.
Okay.
So we came up with a way to do it, and he's just like, oh, and I want to play a rogue. Because that's what I've always played when I've played it in the past. I'm like, yeah, that's no problem. So, I'm introducing their characters. I have them roll to see what order they're going to come into this bar, right?
Uh-huh.
And he comes in, and of course, everyone gets like really, really weirded out by the fact that this lizard folk just walked in,
uh-huh.
Right? And the first thing he says is, he goes, does anybody look particularly wealthy at the bar? And I was just like, oh, God. He's going to go ahead and try to, like, rob somebody or mug somebody. And, you know, he's just like, I have this thing where they're going to go fight a couple of goblins on a farm. But no, it's going to end right here. First session, they're going to get into a bar fight and I'll die. I'm just like, this is more an adventurer's sort of establishment. Like, that's what this tavern is known for. It's why you are here right now. There are some people who have some money here, but they look like they've, like, earned it with their own blood, sweat, and tears.
Right. Okay.
And he's just like, so these are more, like, working-class people. There's no, you know, like, patricians or anything. And like, no, nothing like that. This is a, you know, it is more of, like, a working-class bar. And he goes, okay, that's fine. I'm going to stand up on the table. I'm just like, what is he doing? And then he bursts out into this impression where he introduces himself. And he kept up this impression for close to a year, because that's how long this game ran. He introduces his character to the entire bar very loudly, with a Bernie Sanders impression, where he has named himself Bernie Flanders. He does this toast to like everybody in the bar. And then the waiter comes over and is just like, what are you doing? He goes, I want to buy everybody in the bar a round of whatever. What food are you serving out? And it's like bacon and eggs. He goes, everyone gets eggs, no bacon.
So he walks in, I guess a dragon, what would be almost the equivalent of a dragonborn, except they're not in there. So essentially a dragonborn walks into this bar. No one's ever seen his kind before. He gets up and starts doing his the guy is really doing the Bernie impression. Cause Bernie, I assume, isn't in your Pathfinder game, unless I have some other questions about the game. But,
well,
and then when you say he kept
Pathfinder
up,
canon, technically Bernie Sanders exists, but
I mean,
that's neither here nor there.
Technically any RPG, I guess he could exist. When you said he kept it up, so then later in the campaign, does he drop it? And he's like, no, actually, I'm not this...
No. We just got to the end of the campaign.
Okay, so that was the character. The character was just
character,
a Bernie Sanders Dragonborn.
The character was a Bernie Sanders Dragonborn that he kept up the whole time. But he was playing, he's playing as a drow, because this is just what he really liked to do back then.
Uh-huh.
Comes in as a drow, and everyone's talking, and they're just like, oh yeah, we can go and help this farmer out, because things got back on course after that, right? Mm-hmm. And no joke, as they're leaving the bar, the Bernie Flanders character, he goes, I lean over to Gary's character, and I'm just like, sure. He goes, and I just put my fist up like this, and I go, Black Elves matter. That was the quality of that game.
Aww,
He had,
I mean, yeah, they're discriminated against those drow, so.
well, eventually, and then I was pretty happy with this because I was able to turn it around on him. They tracked down this villain who was somehow or another went to this small little town in the middle of nowhere. It was like it was a former gold mining town, but the mine basically ran dry. There was only lead left in the mine, so they were just like people left the town. The town's fallen on really hard times. There's like 10 people who live there now. He agrees to help out the town on the condition that the blacksmith take on a goblin apprentice with the idea that the local goblin tribes are not a problem. They just need to be given opportunity. So he has this idea like, oh yeah, job training.
Right, right. Make
We're gonna give
peace
free college to the goblins.
to the goblins. Yeah, all right.
So I managed to go ahead and turn this around on him because he's just like, oh yeah, they want to go ahead and have like goblin apprentices. They want to go ahead and have goblin interns, I think is what he actually referred to. They leave town for a while, things happen, and they come back, and it's like a couple of months later, there was a small little excursion out to the plane of shadow, and they came back. A bunch of stuff happens. He comes back, and the town is kind of back together. There's a couple hundred people living there at this point, and there's also kind of goblins running all around the town. One of the ways that the town has reestablished itself is that they thought that this goblin internship worked so well that they realized that the goblins are in fact a source of slavery.
Oh,
Yeah, dial up the guilt on him a little bit. And he's
oh,
just
no.
like, well, I mean, there's only one thing to do here, which is goblin slave revolt.
Oh, so he tried to like make peace by getting an internship the goblin, and then basically when you came back, they're like, "No, we just enslaved all the goblins."
Yep.
And
Unpaid
then,
internships. Unpaid internships.
that's kind of what
The mayor of
slavery
the
is,
town
yeah.
was very insistent on calling them unpaid
Untrained
internships.
internships. Yeah, I'm sure there's a lot of college students out there where that hits very, very close to home. So then he started a revolt.
With the phrase weapons and freedom. So anytime
Okay.
they'd go around town and goblins would see them, they'd do this little hand symbol and say weapons and freedom and goblin that nobody else spoke, just him. It ended with like a big mass riot in the city, and the big bad guy got dragged away by a drider.
By what?
A drider?
A drider. What's a drider?
Yeah, okay, so drow have a in Forgotten Realms, which is roughly where this took place. Drow have a god called Lolth, who is
Okay.
a spider lady.
Oh, okay.
She's
All right.
spider from the waist up and everything else. Oh no, she's human from the waist up or drow
Okay.
from the
I was
waist
like,
up,
whoa.
and everything else is spider.
Gotcha.
So
Very
it's like
cool.
a I don't know the details of him in Forgotten Realms, but in the Pathfinder world, it's a thing drow do called flesh warping, which from the descriptions from what I've read about it is roughly like sculpting a bonsai tree, except with living flesh as opposed to a tree.
Sounds horrifying, to be
Yeah, there are all
honest.
sorts of messed up.
Well, I feel like I've seen only a couple people play a drow, and I know they're supposed to be like bad, but I don't know, they have a lot of those weird traits, but that's like one of the racial traits for the drow in Pathfinder.
No, it's something drow do.
Oh, they just do it.
Pathfinder 2nd edition actually added flesh warps as a playable ancestry.
Oh,
So you can play
okay.
as a flesh warp,
Gotcha.
along with all sorts of weird, grotesque body horror art that they
I'm
put
gonna have to
into
look that up
this
after.
game.
So you seem to, so you're one, you have one friend, you seem to have a lot of people know that like playing drow. You have one guy who kind of made up his own dragon board. What kind of races do you like? What are your favorite races to play? Because like
I don't
your
think I have like a
characters.
favorite race to play. I guess that's not really something I've thought about specifically, because it's like you build a character and like the race or the ancestry and the background and all that stuff, you you put it together into a character.
Gotcha.
Actually, I don't think I've played the same Ancestry twice. Maybe I have. I've played
several
humans. Is
Ancestry different? Is that like background?
Oh, yeah. Pathfinder 2e got rid of the term race and added Ancestry.
Gotcha.
With the idea, partially just to be a little woke, but it's the idea that you have like a dominant ancestry as opposed to these rigidly defined races.
I'm not really mad about that. I mean, they have a little bit of those crossovers, but it does kind of like make sense, I guess, for it kind of is a little more interesting on a role-playing point of view to see everyone kind of as more as equals, but with like more prominent.
One of the reasons I like it is you think about it like you have a half-elf race in D&D and in Pathfinder. Well, half-elves make a lot of sense. Like, one parent is an elf and one parent is a human.
Right.
Right? Or the two parents are half-elves.
Right.
Right? But, like, what if a half-elf and a human get together? What do they produce?
Yeah.
Like, there's no quarter-elf race.
Quarter-elf, yeah. But I guess it does kind of make sense because, like, if you were, like, I don't know, Irish, Italian, and German, you could be like, oh, I'm a quarter of this. But I know it's a little different, but, like, it is kind of interesting for them to do it. So when you build a character, you don't really think too much about that.
Yeah, right. I mean, unless you're making, like, a huge backstory for the character.
Gotcha.
No, so what Paizo did in Pathfinder 2nd Edition is they basically said that your ancestry is whatever your dominant characteristic is.
Gotcha.
And that's what gives you access to certain feats, and that's what gives you, you know, whatever else. It defines if you have low light vision and all that stuff. They then made half elf and half orc, for instance, what they refer to as heritages, things that you can add on to your ancestry.
Okay.
So, for example, I have a character in a current game that I'm playing who is an orc, and his heritage is that he's a hold scar orc, so he comes from a very specific area, and his whole thing is that his group of orcs, they wear all these scars that they have as, like, you know, from battle. They're just like, oh, look at all this. Look at all this that I've done. These are my medals.
Right.
So they're very proud of their scars. So they added half-orc and half-elf as these heritages. Technically, like, rules as written, they're only supposed to be applied to humans. Okay. But you could apply them to anything else.
So then, and that's in addition to your primal, like, your primary heritage, you just get these other little kind of...
Yeah, so there's an ancestry and a heritage that you pick right at the beginning.
That's kind of cool. I like, the phrasing of that is different than just, like, racial traits and stuff. I could see the wokeness behind Pathfinder 2 is pretty cool about that.
People have criticized Paizo for kind of going too woke with Pathfinder 2. But there's a lot of weird stuff that happens in the Pathfinder world, so I don't know if you can accuse them of being too entirely woke.
I mean, there's a lot of weird stuff that happened. I think I was learning the other day how there's, like, tons of books on how certain races reproduce and stuff like that. It's like, yeah, I think that's gets a little deep for me, to be honest.
What is it? Book of Erotic Magic?
I don't know.
I think that was what it was
probably
called?
I'm sure it all exists. Yeah. I'm sure
it
all exists.
3.5 had a third party thing that came out that was essentially all erotic magic. To which Wizards of the Coast went, well, we are done with this.
Yeah, that's
this open gaming license, we are done with that.
Time for a new...
In the 5th edition, all of the supplements that you get from third parties, they all have to be approved through, like, the DM's Guild and stuff like that.
Yeah, that kind of makes sense. Yeah. People
we're not going to let people just license.
Make your own weird dice-rolling sex game, but let's keep this fun and crazy.
Wizards was just like, we need to exert a little more control over our brand.
Nice. So you play in Pathfinder. Have you ever had a character, like, really die horribly? I haven't gotten any of those stories. I'm trying to dig for one.
Oh,
because I've been lucky enough where I haven't lost anyone yet.
Let's see. characters that have died horribly very recently. This character didn't die, but probably wishes he did.
Oh no. oh no.
This was in my friend's homebrew world. It was roughly pirate themed.
That's fun.
And this just happened a few weeks ago, so it's even fresh in my mind. He was a gunslinger.
Is this in Pathfinder though?
This is in Pathfinder.
So yeah. Pathfinder also has a gunslinger.
Pathfinder has a gunslinger. Yep.
Cool.
So the it's not one of the core classes, it's one of the, I think they refer to them as base classes. They were in the advanced guide.
Yeah.
So the so he was a gunslinger. He basically walked around with a double-barreled musket. He could do completely ridiculous amounts of damage. He's a level 10 character. What was his name? Powder Monkey.
Powder Monkey. A double-barrel musket? Do you have to, like, reload? Like, how do you load a double-barrel musket?
There's, normally it takes, a standard action.
Uh-huh.
So, okay, Pathfinder rules, really quickly.
You got the three actions, right?
You have three actions. In first edition, it's, a standard action, a swift action, and a move action.
Okay.
Not too dissimilar from 5th edition's action, bonus action, move.
Gotcha. Right.
Normally it's a standard action to load a two-handed rifle. He had a bunch of feats and a bunch of magic items and stuff like that that basically brought it all the way down to a free action.
Uh-huh.
So the way I described it is he has this prehensile tail that was constantly handing him the next shells that he was loading in and just like clicking the release, popping out the old shells and putting the new ones in. So you could actually fire six times around if you needed to.
Oh my god.
it was a ridiculous amount of damage. It was great. The first round of combat that we had, I did just a full round of shooting.
Uh-huh.
And the GM was just like, oh, this is a lot more damage than I was expecting.
Right. Oh.
We ended up on a ship, and we were chasing down somebody who tried to assassinate the prince. We chased down the ship. We ended up essentially killing everybody on board the ship. There was a couple of random people, except there was a wizard who, way at the beginning of the fight, disappeared.
Okay.
And at first, I'm like, okay, he's invisible. He's somewhere. He's going to pop up again. Right? But then he didn't. Like, we got through most of the combat. We killed the captain of the ship that we were taking over. There was a couple of other people who were around who weren't really much of a threat. And then everybody on board the ships, you know, the non-threatening people really, they start attacking each other and killing each other. Right?
Okay.
And I was like, this is weird. And now my character is just sort of like, moving around the ship trying to see where this wizard may have gone.
Alright. So you assume that, like, these people trying to kill each other is because of this wizard that you still have?
I mean, I didn't care. Like, Powder Monkey didn't care why they were killing each other. He's just like, you know, there's a bigger threat out here somewhere.
I know the wizard's here somewhere.
I need to hunt him down.
We'll find him.
Right?
Okay.
And I searched a good portion of the ship, and I'm just like, maybe just teleported away. Right. The other characters at this point are just like, no, these people are fighting. We have to do something about this. And I'm just like, no, I'm chaotic neutral. I flirt with evil. I don't care. These people can kill themselves. Right. So they go ahead and they tie up the last person.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And they're going to start questioning him to see, you know, like, hey, why did you start killing each other? Like, they're gonna try to figure this out.
Mm-hmm.
And then my character, who does not have good will saves, wisdom saves, gets dominate person casted on him from nowhere.
Oh.
Right? Suddenly this wizard appears, right? He was having everybody kill each other to basically cover up the fact that he was there.
Mm-hmm.
So I get dominate person cast on me, and Dominate person always comes with like an order.
Right.
So he says, kill everybody.
Oh.
And now I happen to be standing right next to, you know, some of the other characters. So one of the other characters manages to fascinate me so I can't actually shoot him. Right? There's this really, really like tense, like trying to figure out that they have this one guy who is able to put a lot of lead downrange real quick.
Mm-hmm.
As long as he's fascinated, nobody dies. So we just
what
need to find out.
Fascinated.
Oh, fascinated is a condition in Pathfinder.
Okay.
Usually, I think the requirement is that you have to always make a move action towards what fascinates you,
okay.
Unless you're standing right next to it, in which case you just like stare. So it's a pretty debilitating condition to have.
Right. Oh, that makes sense.
It gets broken really, really easily. So, like,
okay.
If the condition that's fascinating you ends, you're no longer fascinated. If something aggressive happens towards you, you lose the fascination.
I identify with this a lot.
Yeah. So it's a very debilitating condition, but it's very easily broken.
Okay, so you're cast Dominate Person, then
mm-hmm.
your party's
and then
like...
fascinated.
Yeah, your party's like, oh, wait, look at the shiny thing over here,
exactly.
here.
Exactly, yeah. So, so they come up with this, and then they're trying to figure out, like, if they find the wizard and they kill the wizard, then my dominate person goes away. There's nobody to give me a new order. They're just like, okay, we can figure this out. What happened after that? The fascination ended, I can't remember why, it was because he tried to do something that would have, like, they were working on their plan, basically,
gotcha.
Right?
So the fascination was broken.
He had to end the fascination to work on the rest of the plan. So
gotcha.
Now it's just this ticking timer of initiative order until my character comes up and does like 80 something damage.
Oh my gosh.
To this dude who has like 15 hit points left. He goes ahead and tries it, rolls. The plan fails from like step one, right?
Mm-hmm.
They don't have enough time to put anything up, you know, back against my character, so my character goes ahead and unloads on this poor dude and takes him down. And then the GM is just like, okay, well, Ken's character is, you know, killing people on board. And I go, the closest person to me at this point is the wizard, and he said to kill everybody. He is part of everybody.
That's true.
And the GM is just like, damn.
Oh, that is...
So I'm just like, so I'm going to full round against the wizard.
Oh,
and I
man.
Score a crit on it.
Oh my god.
The wizard walks away with 6 hit points.
Oh, he escaped.
He still has 6 hit points, and he's like flying and all this other stuff. And I knew he was going to go ahead and, you know, the next round that he had, he was going to change the order to kill everyone except me. So it's like,
right.
This is the
okay.
one chance.
Yeah. Oh my god, that's so funny. The technicality of the phrasing.
So,
oh, that was good. That's really smart.
Yeah,
unlike
he was just like, that was a really good loophole. I have to give it to you.
Oh yeah. That's, yeah.
But then, Powder Monkey doesn't manage to take down the wizard. So he eventually goes ahead and kills the other party members.
Oh.
And then goes ahead and kills the entire crew of his ship, kills any remaining crew that was on the other ship, and then this wizard is just like, okay, well, you're still killing everybody, and then uses a spell called Ice Crystal Teleport to just send him somewhere else in the world. It's basically like forcing somebody else to teleport, not teleporting yourself.
Oh, so he sent your gunslinger away?
Yep.
After that?
So he just teleported somewhere else into like a town somewhere.
So everyone died.
To kill
just everyone died.
So everybody died.
So that's the end. This was recent. Just a total.
Yeah, this was just a one shot.
Essentially a TPK, and then you're. Well,
my
your
group
guy's
has a
still
thing...
live. So he was just sent to another place to just
yep.
deal. Are you aware when you come out of a spell like that? You're aware.
You're aware of what you're doing as you're doing it.
Oh.
Yeah,
oh,
so he didn't
hurts.
Die, but he probably wishes he did.
Oh man, that's really, really painful on the inside.
It was kind of like this whole big like Greek tragedy thing in the
Yeah,
background, because like
it's so poetic. Like,
the beginning of the campaign was
oh
just
my
like, not campaign, the
God.
beginning of the adventure was like, you're level 10 characters, you decide how you know each other or if you know each other, right?
Yeah.
But basically, you know there is a meeting going on here. It is supposed to be secret, but it is like the worst kept secret
Oh.
in this little islands of pirate islands. So we're all there basically like looking to get a job for this deal that's about to go down. So like my character meets up with this other character, and they all kind of know each other, and they've probably been on the same side and on the opposite side of a bunch of different like conflicts over time. So they like meet, and we have this like scene that we role played of like all these old war stories that we're going back and forth about, right? Like, oh hey, I'm surprised you're still alive with the way,
Right.
like you didn't blow yourself up yet. No, I'm still here. Lost a finger, but I'm still here.
That.
And then he kills all his old war buddies
Oh my
because
God.
of a
He
dominant
killed
person.
all his. Oh my God. That's like. That's worse than your character dying. Is like. You should, like, if you ever play another level like that, you should use that character again, because he's still alive, and have him with, like, horrid PTSD from the shit he went through. That is a really crazy story. That is a very, very, very good story. I kind of want to, I think, how long have we, let's see, what has it been about? About 50 minutes. I think we're gonna end on that nightmare
Sure.
of a basically a TPK. Wow. Well, anyone listening, thank you so much for hanging on to the stream. If you want to be on the show, it's really simple. You follow me, follow the show on Twitch, or it is on Spotify and a bunch of other podcasts for just the audio. And then you just send me an email at youhadtobetheredndpodcast@gmail.com. The DND in the email is just with the letters, not the symbol. Very simple. And I want to hear some more crazy stories like this one right here. So yeah, this audio will go up next week on Wednesday. That's when the audio gets posted. I have a few other episodes posted, and you can watch the videos on my Twitch channel. So thanks everyone again for listening. This has been You Had to Be There, a D&D storytelling podcast with Kenneth Blaney.